It can be said without much disagreement that today any higher or sophisticated or more critical discussion of gender and sexuality must take into consideration the arguments and propositions of Judith Butler. Yet, it is also true that Butler is one of the most difficult authors of English studies today, much like Bhabha. There have also been allegations against her that she uses this kind of a circumlocutory and evasive style to hide paucity of original thought. That is a different thing. I'll not talk about it today, but we'll try to make Judith Butler easy for you, easier. Of course, you have to read your own Butler, especially the essay Imitation and Gender Insubordination. One of our scholars did do some talk on that, and I have also discussed earlier. But right now, I have, you know, categorized four or five very important things related to Butler, which will make you understand Butler in a much easier way. One thing is, I will contest that Butler is more of a post-structuralist than a gender theorist. This is a kind of JC's take on this. So you will find everywhere that she is a gender theorist influenced by post-structuralism, but I would say the reverse, that she is, by the very makeup, a post-structuralist, and gender is incidental. I know it's a radical claim, but we must be true to our own feeling. Why I'm saying so? Her basic theories of gender, or even elaborate theories of gender, is mostly nothing but tenets of post-structuralism applied to already existing gender theories, right? So you will understand now what I say, what I've said just now, when we go to her propositions step by step. First thing that we have to know about post-structuralism and consequently about Butler is that post-structuralism by and large posits that there is no unmediated access to knowledge. Knowledge per se is not out there. Even that I am talking to you, giving you some knowledge, how is it happening? Through language. Through YouTube, that is another matter, but primary media is language. So can there be a knowledge which is outside language? No. Post-structuralism answers in the negative. So all knowledges are constituted by language or specific languages, and hence they are subject to the violences, rules and restrictions of that language. This is number one related to Butler. So she will extend it and argue that all our understanding of gender is basically related to the tools available in the language about gender. Okay? Male, female, man, woman, whatever. So, second point, here she is slightly, and some would say quite, some people keep arguing that Butler is very different from Simone de Beauvoir, but that is exactly not the case. In certain points, she appears to be very different, and at other points, she conflates the difference. Anyway, like Simone de Beauvoir, Irigaray, Walter, all the feminists belonging to different, you know, ages, epistemes, locations, and enunciations, what is their basic contestation? That a female identity is suppressed or misrepresented or has to be represented properly, is not it? So Butler strikes at the very root here. She says there is no essential female identity outside representation, outside language, outside discourse. The identity, female identity itself, is a construct which is no doubt subject to the rules of the discourse that constitutes it, but at the same time it is pointless or futile to talk about a proper representation of a female identity, because there is no female identity as such, or no male identity as such. Here she is quite different from her feminine, earlier feminists. Then the third, a very interesting point, which is also original about her gender theory, is that related to this, the next point is, she goes back to Freud also, all right. Freud has read the basis of all sexual activities, or sexual roles rather, not activities, roles and rules and conducts, is related to incest taboo. Yes, that is the sex between close bloods. It exists in the world of nature, if you observe lower animals, but not in human. In all societies that we know, the degrees of incest are different. For example, in today's Hindu society and all, cousins are also thought part of close bond, and hence marriage not allowed. But then in other societies, they are different. However, as a father, mother, own sister, brother, this thing, this is incest, is prohibited. You cannot have sexual relation with them. So according to Freud, this is the primary rule of sexual behavior of humans. And if you have read Jacques Derrida's that famous thing, Structure, Sign and Play in the Discourse of the Human Sciences, this argument is also one of the moot point while establishing his case of the bricolure. And then that this incest taboo, though it is cultural, but it is also in a sense natural, because this taboo is found in all human societies, whether in Japan or in, you know, Pakistan or in India. There is no sex allowed between close degree of relatives or close blood relations rather, all right. Now, this is what Freud said. Now, Butler goes on step further and says that there is yet another taboo, which precedes this gender, this incest taboo, that is homosexuality taboo. Homosexuality is not allowed in sexual discourses. Here, there, Butler, there is some problem, because there are some societies in Africa, of course very minor, there are some kind of a man-to-man behavior or youth-to-man behavior is allowed at some part, but of course Butler is right in the sense that that not recognized as part of full-fledged mature sexuality. So she has went beyond Freud and established this through her argument that the basic taboo is not the incest taboo of human sexuality, but the taboo on homosexuality. So she has, I'll just read out her statement, rather the term, that this, but that you cannot have sex with your own gender or sex create a loss, a melancholy, conscious or unconscious, in all subjects, not only homosexuals. So finally all become, to some extent more or less a melancholic heterosexual identity. Here I am reminded of Antonio's words in the beginning of The Merchant of Venice. In sooth, I know not why I am so sad. It worries me, you say it worries you, etc., etc. Antonio's sadness, which has been later related by critics to his homosexual feelings for Bassanio, and his, we can say, premonition or knowledge that he is going to leave him soon, Bassanio, by marrying Portia. Now, this is one point number three, right? First point I said is this post-structuralist. Second point I have said that there is no essential gender identity outside language. Following the third point is Freud. And then that she goes beyond Freud and saying that the basic taboo in human sexuality is the taboo prescribing homosexuality. Now, relate this to Sedgwick's Urban Bachelor or other videos on queer theory that I have made, then your understanding will be more mature. Now, this second and third point that I have mentioned are rarely mentioned in any video or texts on Butler. So I've done my own research, so you remember this. But the first point, in a certain different way, post-structuralism often mentioned, and what I'm going to mention now is quite easily available. That is, finally she says that sexuality, or gender is nothing but a performance. That is, you keep repeating certain sets of behavior which society has mandated for you. So there is nothing essentially true or intrinsic about gender. So gender is the repeated stylization of the body, a set of repeated acts within a highly rigid regulatory framework that congeal over time to produce the appearance of substance, a natural sort of being. If you look at this statement closely, it is nothing but a linguistic reconstruction and a bit problematization of what Beauvoir said. We are not born but made women. Though she spoke only about women, but it's true about men and everyone. That is, gender is a stylized repetition. So you have to be man, like masculine, like this. For example, no bodybuilder, women, you have to smile, kebab. In between, then you will be called a masculine, female, feminine, which are not liked by society. You become a butt of joke, ridicule, etc. So there may not be anything natural between being born with a, you know, male attributes, rather male sexual attributes, and then being like this always. But then society indoctrinates. So people often miss that part, that Butler said gender is a stylized repetition of the body. They just think that it is free. No, it's not free, because the rules of that play are fixed, so she says, in a highly rigid regulatory framework. So what is that regulatory framework? Of that heteronormativity, heterosexuality, or heteropatriarchy, as you call it. So your performances will have to be within that. You can be different kinds of heroes, but a man has to be hero. If a man is not heroic, then he will not be a man proper. And if he behaves womanly, then he will be treated as joker. You know, at one point of time, most of the Hindi movies, one of frequent others were the third gender people. People laughed at them, smiled. I don't think it has gone away totally now. So that is very cruel. That is pathetic anyway. So gender is stylish repetition. Okay, remember this. So that means there is nothing essential between your sex and your nothing essentially common between being born with a sex and then having a specific gender related to that sex. Now here comes the fifth point, which, as I said earlier, some people though it's not the fifth point I have said earlier, that some people emphasize on that a lot, that Butler said gender and sex are both constructs. Yes, she said that, but then she said other things also, but right now I'll speak about that. How, for example, in Simone de Beauvoir, you know it well, male or female, you know, these are part of sex. You are born with a male sex organ, female sex organ, or, you know, one in between, whatever, but primarily we'll talk about men and women, right? But then you are made to be a male or female, masculine or feminine. So sex is natural, gender is cultural. Butler doesn't agree. The moment you know a child is born, you call it a man. So at the same time, you are imposing on it certain rules and certain roles which have been associated with men that the child will have to perform throughout his life. If he or she does not conform, then marginalized, tortured. You know, that is the main thing why we do gender studies. That is, if one is different and one is happy in his or her own way, no problem. But then society does not tolerate third gender or people who behave non-normatively while being first and second gender. So a masculine, female or feminine man, these are not welcome by society, heteropatriarchal structure of the society. So that's why we are undoing gender, a famous name of a Judith Butler book. So have you got it? So male and female may be cultural, you know, but man and women, they are also not, you know, natural category or vice versa. Actually, we cannot say that sex is natural and gender is cultural, because the, again I repeat, the moment you say that one is born a man or a boy, you already have in your mind a set of formula of what a boy has to do or a girl has to do, all right? So while understanding Butler, you have to considerably come out of this idea that sex is natural and gender is cultural. In fact, sex is also cultural. Now, here lies a prominent criticism of Butler. Then do you totally negate that there is intrinsic about sex? She doesn't answer that. She mostly asks questions, doesn't answer. You know, God, she will say that, not in denial, but I'm emphasizing this. But how it is possible, if you say that gender is, now I'm coming to the criticism that sex is also cultural, how is it possible then that, you know, a child can be born only when a man and women come together? Now, some devotees of gender, you know, Butler will give example that in such and such a family, a man became a woman, then married a man, and then they had a child. But this is only through intervention of science, technology, all right? So, that everything in sex is construct. I'm not talking about gender. Gender is definitely a construct, but the fact that sex is totally a construct, not acceptable. And here again, I'd like to talk in general about the difference between constructionists and scientists. You know, broadly, Beauvoir or Butler, all these people, in spite of their differences, they are known as constructionist or constructivist, etc. That is, those who believe that gender and everything, these are social constructs. Now, constructivists do not see anything essential in the primary categories and primary identities. Now, that is actually, that cannot be true. There are many things which come to us naturally, and then that cannot be denied. You know, it will be counterfactual. So if I say that the sun does not rise in the sky, it is only an effect of language. S-U-N, sun, refers to sun because it doesn't refer to moon and all, right? But theoretically it is all right, but it will be counterfactual. Anyway, I will elaborate on this on some other occasion. Now, coming to the repetition. So that is, gender is realized when you keep repeating certain roles. And here again, a very, very important and insightful point from Butler. We generally think that our enacting gender roles, male role, female role, are effects of our being men and women or male and female. But no, she argues, the very performances of our male roles or female roles construct us as men or women. So it is the very opposite. So that is why it is deconstructionist. Let me clarify it by giving another example. See, in school grammar, we are taught that what is language? Language is the medium of expression of our thought, is not it? So language is the medium of expression of our thought. It is said in English books, in Bangla books, Moner Bhav Prakasher Madhyam Ke Bhasha Bole, right? But when you come to deconstruction or postmodern, you are made to think that, can you think without language? No. So if language is the medium of your thought of expression, then how does the thought take place? It itself takes place in language. So thought itself is made possible by language. So instead of saying that language is the vehicle of thought, we come to see, thanks to this part is good of post-structuralism, that thought itself is an effect of language. The cow doesn't think, at least so far as we know, they act instinctually and maybe some very basic answer, because they do not have language. They have communicative sounds. But when we say language, it is a chain of signifiers, signify, displacement, deferral, etc. That a cow does not have, goat does not have, they may be having within themselves in secret, but we are yet to know they haven't. To. Dogs, they have significant, I mean, they have communicating science, verbal science, basic science, but not like us. So you cannot think in that thing. Or at least even if you think, you cannot think in like ours. So you'll ask me, where is the proof? Well, that I'm talking to you over, you know, YouTube itself is the proof. The dog or the cow or the goat, they haven't been able to make, you know, YouTube or computer or, you know, this mobile. They haven't written books so far. So that means thought is not there, creative thought or developed thought, because language is not there. Alright, so now come to Butler's proposition that we are wrong in thinking that our male or female role, etc., are products of our being man or women. It is the reverse. The more we keep acting the roles, the more we become defined as man or women, or third gender if you act like that. So it is the acts or performances which actually create your gender, not your sex. And in fact, they can be said to constitute your sex also, because as I've said already, for Butler, you know, these two are more or less same, that you cannot call sex is fully natural or natural. So this is mimesis or psychic mimesis. Mimesis means imitation, the last part. So imitation and gender insubordination. Now, when does gender insubordination? Insubordination is defiance, not following. So take the case of drag. In gay life or queer life or even today in general life, it is very well known. Drag is that occasion where men perform mostly as women. Other things are also there, but mostly men, a drag queen, etc. So in drag, what is happening is that the men are imitating women's roles by doing female gender. So by doing that, they are problematizing the very category of not only female gender, but gender itself, because then it becomes evident that gender is something that is produced through imitation. So when we go to drag, it becomes visible like a play within a play. But if we extend our understanding of drag, it becomes clear, if we look at it from Butler's perspective, that all our gender identities are basically results of repetition. You behave like a man, behave like woman, whether in, you know, public room or bedroom or this, and different roles have been. And then again, I must warn you, she never says that the rules are flexible. These are heteropatriarchal rules, and then rules and roles, and these are fixed. So only in cases of things like drag, you challenge this role and role publicly. Of course, now in other parts of society also is happening. Unisex saloons are there, dresses are also been swapped, but very limited. But a drag is a kind of devastative critic of gender. That is, there lies the importance of drag. And so, this is what Butler doesn't say but imply, and I'm saying it clearly. So, the more we mix up or mess up or kind of play with the gender roles, there will be more freedom from, gender violence and gender subordination. That is what Butler wants. Now coming to the core Beej mantra, in a way, we can say that is from Butler, more or less, finally the point that emerges is that, this is my, as long as you are caught in that dichotomy of man, woman, man, female, it is very difficult to come out of the clutches of gender. There should be absolute fluidity, and if possible, go beyond gender. That is what she says. So that's why I say that I am a post-gender person, PG. You are doing PG postgraduate, so you also try to be PG, post, gender, at least in ideology. It doesn't mean that you have to go and act in the drag, and I'm not saying that, but the ideology of the drag, that is fluidity, countering gender norms. So these are the important things. So the moment you understand that gender is nothing essential, but our repetition, it is not only culture, but it is in our very repetition of certain acts which have been laid down for society by patriarchy or heteropatriarchy that we become man or women or even third genders. So that is mimesis, mimetic aspect of gender. And one interesting last point is that if these are mimesis, heterosexuality itself is a mimesis. You know, you people keep performing heterosexual roles that have been expected of them, that have been imposed on them by society. Then what is the origin? So there is no origin, to Butler. So these are copies and copies and copies. Of course, copy and, imitation or mimesis are not exactly the same thing. Copy is mechanical, robotic, which doesn't mean that. That is the difference between Plato's mimesis and Butler's mimesis. So this imitation is not slavish. You have freedom, but very limited freedom. You cannot go beyond your gender roles, broader gender roles. But whether he will like this or like this kind of freedom you have. So that is the imitation. So imitation and gender insubordination. So gender itself is imitation. So in first semester you had learned that from Plato, not me, I was a mediator, that literature or even reality itself is mimesis, copy of copy. And now in fourth semester to end, this is again, gender is a copy, copy of copy of copy. Of course, if you think about Plato in a bigger way, Butler is already ordained in Plato. That is, this is my edition, because for him everything here is a copy. But then this is a religious tenet, logocentric, that there is a divine world of which these are copies. But in Butler, no such logocentrism is there. So these are copies without any origin. I hope this will help you, even if it helps you a little in understanding Butler, I'll be helped very much. This is not only for exam or textbooks, but for life. Thank you.